So this session is going to be called Members Talk Back. The great thing about the OpenShift Commons is it's not sort of a traditional sort of foundation as we're seeing a lot today where it's mostly vendors. This has been made up sort of from the beginning of obviously a bunch of technology vendors because we're trying to get towards common standards and common best practices and so forth. But it's also made up of a ton of working groups and meeting groups of sort of end user customers, as well as a bunch of systems integrators and other folks who are helping us scale this. So what we brought today was a set of people from those different backgrounds. And so we hope we can give you guys a good sense of how the project is working from end users' perspectives, from folks who are trying to do systems integration along vertical axes, telcos, service providers, and also the technology vendors as well. And again, same as the other panels, we're going to throw out some topics for these folks to talk about. If you have questions, raise your hand. We'll get you a microphone, and we'll kind of go from there. So I'm going to do a quick introduction. I'm going to kind of introduce all of you, and then I'll let you guys do a quick introduction. Andrew Randall, CEO from Tigera. Bjarte Jarlsson from the, and I'm going to get this wrong, so let me just give you the basic, from the tax group of Norway. You're in charge of all the taxes of Norway.
Norwegian tax authority, yeah.
That's right.
Norwegian tax authority.
And I would pronounce that so badly, so I'm going to skip that. Darren Ratcliffe from the cloud group at Atos, and Josh Mayer from Accenture, from the financial services group of Accenture. Andrew, why don't you start, just quick introduction, and what your role is in, as far as working with the OpenShift Commons community.
Sure, yeah. So we set up Tigera because we saw a lot of issues with how virtual networking had worked in the VM world and OpenStack, and we really wanted to kind of start over with cloud native and do it right. And so we do this with an open source project called Calico. The initial integration, obviously, in terms of cloud native things was with Kubernetes, and we've been working in that community for a long time. And more recently, been looking at how do we actually make this a really seamless, smooth experience for OpenShift users as well. So we've actually just, in fact, I just heard today we've got that merged into the OpenShift project. So hopefully, be there in 1.5 and OpenShift Origin. And so it's pretty early days for us in terms of the engagement on the OpenShift side, but we've been in the Kubernetes side for a long time.
Right.
That's our role.
Cool. Yarte.
So I work in the government in Norway, or in the IT partner for the tax, like the tax authority in Norway. So we are currently developing our new platform to run and develop application. It's based on OpenShift container platform. It's the latest release. We've been doing this for 16 months or something, since the 103 Origin release or something. So it's we're kind of just creating, we're using OpenShift, some glue on top to integrate with our existing infrastructure and our existing demands, because we got lots of them. We're a government, so we have lots of QA processes and QA teams and lots of different environments for all the applications. Like the guy from Volvo said, they have test and QA in production. We have like 7 steps or something that we need to go through. So we have lots of things we need to do, but we try to automate as much as we can.
Hi, I'm Darren from Atos. I work in our technical strategy part of the business within our business and platform services. We're working jointly with Red Hat on our customer base, where we're helping them to help deploy OpenShift platforms. Particularly in the area of operating those, looking at how they scale those, how they integrate them into the ecosystem. So working with the guys at Weave, as an example, on how you integrate in visualization and operational tooling that helps them as part of their CI/CD process. Also within Atos, we've got a large contingent of developers, and we're helping to help them understand how you start to use these sorts of platforms to build applications in a more cloud-native, microservice sort of way, so that we can support our customers not just only in the delivery of OpenShift platforms and Kubernetes, but also in the actual life cycle of the applications as they build those to address their new business value that they're looking to create.
Josh.
Josh Meyer. So I lead a group within Accenture that's focused on cloud enablement within the financial service industry. So that's a small part of a much bigger group within our overall businesses focused on cloud. But through that collaboration, we've done a lot with both with Red Hat around OpenShift, but also directly around the Kubernetes. So we've deployed some fairly large Kubernetes clusters. And we're involved at the moment on my patch with a number of our financial services clients around significant transformations of their applications into OpenShift. And I particularly look at quite a broader set as well. I'm been working a lot with Red Hat in the broader sense also around the cloud orchestration topic. I think a lot of our financial services clients are still in a transition phase, and so there's still a lot of workloads that are not going to live in OpenShift, and how do you orchestrate all that together so that seamlessly you can start transforming and playing with apps that are in OpenShift as well as outside. We're doing a lot of that stuff.
Very cool. So before we jump into questions, one of the things that I get all the time as I get a chance to get out and talk to the marketplace is people go, Kubernetes, cool, it's been out there for 18 months, 2 years, and it's an open source project, and it moves really fast, and is anybody using this? And one of the things about working for a public company is you can't usually disclose all your customers, but there is these fantastic services that talk about people that are hiring for jobs that are more than public. So I'd like to use some of that data, talk about sort of who's using Kubernetes so that people have a sense of, like, are there other people putting their jobs on the line? Are there important services that are being delivered? And I kind of frame it up like this. The financial services industry trusts this. Planes, trains, and automobiles trust this. The media industry trusts this. The travel industry trusts it. Big manufacturing trusts it, and on and on and on. And it's kind of a nice thing. It gives you a sense of, I'm not alone in this, which obviously we're talking about here at OpenShift Commons. But it also gives you a sense that as you're deploying Kubernetes, you're deploying OpenShift, there are people who are solving similar type of scale problems, solving similar types of how fast can I deploy problems, mobile problems, big data problems, and so forth. So it's nice to have a sense of, you know, how big this community is starting to get. I thought what I would talk about with these gentlemen is really kind of these four things. We've been talking about all the different stuff we wanted to hit on. Kind of wanted to talk about these four topics. And guys, I don't want to put any pressure on you, but we're sort of like right at that perfect lunch coma cycle. So I need some good answers, I need some good discussions, and again, questions from the audience. So we're going to talk a little bit about what their experience has been with OpenShift, some of their experiences with decision making, you know, what the people and process and squishy, you know, meatware part of these types of challenges, how do I move to these new things. We're going to talk a little bit about fast-moving projects, the joys of upgrading every 3 months if that's the cycle you want to keep up with, and then we're going to talk a little bit about, you know, in an OpenShift context, when should I use my own project, i.e. Prometheus, versus what's embedded in the stack, and when is it a good decision, and why did that decision get made, and how should you think about that? So lots of stuff we could talk about. We're going to kind of hit on these four things. Guys, I'm going to start sort of to begin with. Give me a sense, give me an experience from each of your perspectives, what you've seen in terms of working with OpenShift, whether it's how your customers have adopted it, how the technology has rolled out, both in terms of, you know, positives and some challenges. But I'm going to sort of throw these out to you guys as a thing. So jump in anywhere you want to, rather than doing the up and down the aisle first. So actually, why don't you start as the sort of end customer? You've got the most scars in this. Why don't you give us a sense of what your experience has been so far?
Yeah, well, our experience is mostly positive about this. We have some. A part of our organization is more skeptical than other parts of it. That's natural. I think it's healthy to be a little bit skeptic about new technology. But we have a good experience running this. We're very happy with the way, like, the building blocks of OpenShift, like the scheduler and the API server, and the APIs are very flexible. It's easy for us to integrate our external services in. We use the same technology that you use internally with labels and listening to labels and creating controllers for integrating our own stuff. Like, we have mostly, we are forced to use Oracle for storage because that's what we do currently. We want to kind of do more, but as of this moment, Oracle is what we do. So we integrated that into our project. So you just say, I want an Oracle database with some information about it, and we create it for you, and we inject it in. So we via a secret and a config map. So the API is very flexible. It's very easy to integrate your existing stuff into it, and that's really important for us. So it works really well.
I'd add maybe if I look back at the probably last five, 6 years where a lot has been happening in the PaaS space, the difference between maybe a lot of the IaaS experiences versus the containerization PaaS space is I think there's been a lot more positive experiences very quickly, whereas a lot of people had very big frustrations early on with complexity of OpenStack or other big deployments and a lot of lost money and investment in projects that maybe didn't quite deliver the value they wanted, whereas PaaS has often really delivered value, particularly directly to the business, much, much quicker. And certainly developers have taken on to this, you know, very, very quickly. Even some of the earlier versions of OpenShift, before it was using Kubernetes, and some of the customers that are directly using Kubernetes. But I think the struggle has been, and where the PaaS space has really matured a lot, is the operator side, where I'm starting to see a lot of the operators now really get much more value that they feel like, yes, this is making my life easier as well. Whereas the developers have kind of been convinced for some years already. In fact, I've seen a couple where developers have started now, you know, the story was always SaaS was being bought on a credit card by the business. I've seen developers buying PaaS on their credit card to bypass their infrastructure folks, right? And so the interesting thing is I think developers were convinced already for a while, and now we're getting the operator train really involved, and they're starting to see the value in some of this. But that's also bringing the broader complexity of some of these, certainly our customers, very, very large organizations that deal with security, regulation, other things they need to still adhere to.
Yeah, and you think part of that is because containers are now sort of that common language that the dev team and the ops team can both sort of talk about, as opposed to ops being sort of a black box in previous PaaS frameworks?
Yeah, by the way, I'm not, I don't know what the others agree, but I'm not sure we're quite there yet, yeah. Right? There's still a lot of organizations that are struggling culturally with that, you know, developer operator mix, and what's the, if you want to call it, the kind of common rule book in the new world. I'd say there's still a lot of work there, and that's cultural change. And for me, I often tell my customers that the technology is the easy part of this, right? It's the cultural things that's really difficult to get it right. But I don't,
I was just gonna agree. I think that my experience of working with customers with regards to implementing Kubernetes and OpenShift is that the technology isn't the main challenge, right? The introduction into an organization, the necessity to change the processes, we've just heard from Volvo, the whole culture shift, you know, reshaping your development organization, those sorts of things are the more challenging spaces. So to be able to go in and help a customer holistically helps with the adoption of the technology. I would say that the speed of maturity with regards to Kubernetes, with the way that how quickly the gaps have been closing, you know, so the challenges and the questions that we get back from customers with what about this, what about that. You heard earlier from Clayton, you know, RBAC and all those things that are coming into the core Kubernetes, and then also heard from Clayton how the baking period between a Kubernetes release and an OpenShift release, particularly in the enterprise release of OpenShift, gives it that extra curation time, and then the commercial support backed off to Red Hat to take care of any issues. You know, I think we're all helping with regards to putting a mindset in place for the wider adoption of containers moving forward.
Yep.
Yeah. So I'd echo all of those things. I think another dimension that's been I've found really interesting over the last year or so has been how fast the topic of hybrid cloud has really come in, and not in the sense that people originally envisaged it of, you know, applications spanning multiple clouds, but with the desire to be deploying applications that can move from one cloud to another, so that they don't have the lock into the cloud provider, and I've certainly seen, for instance, you know, large financial customer who probably, you know, 2 years ago they would never have thought of moving or core application code into public cloud, and I've seen them doing that with this technology, and you know, we're providing the security piece that enables them to really authenticate that, you know, what they think is talking to them from the public cloud is coming back into the core database, which is still on premise, you know, is trusted. But you know, the ability to to build that in a kind of orchestrated container environment was really key to moving it into. In fact, in that case, that application is movable across two different public cloud providers. So I think that's for me is I've seen a real kind of mindset change. And that customer as well, another kind of anecdote here, I guess, is we first helped them with a proof of concept probably January, February last year. And that was a small initial upfront engagement, just a kind of bit of consultancy really to help them get that going. And then they came back, within 7 or 8 months, which is pretty fast, right? From a POC, they came back and said, okay, this is now our strategic platform for all our applications going forward. And so you guys had better work out how you're going to help us support a production environment, come and train, more than like the one engineer who knows about this, because our whole team is going to need to understand this. And so it really, for a large tier one financial to go from POC through to this being the key strategic platform in less than 9 months, I think speaks to how fast this is really getting adopted and how easy it is to adopt as well.
Yeah, no, I think and I think we hear that from a Red Hat perspective, we hear that in probably 60-70% of the customers we engage with. It's how am I going to get this to also work on Azure, on AWS, on GCP, on somewhere other than my own data center for a bunch of different reasons. So we see that pretty consistently. I wanted to talk a little about decision making, and Josh, I'm going to start with you. I thought it was sort of interesting. You get into decision making, and people want to talk about things like Conway's Law. I'm going to give Robert a little bit of a hard time. He talks at a lot of our events. There used to be this thing with Volvo where the joke about sort of the Volvo thing was they're boxy but they're safe. And I was watching his deployment thing, his sort of before, and it dawned on me their old CI deployment thing was it was boxy but it was safe. And the nice thing that's kind of cool is walking with that, his after picture is now we use OpenShift, we go faster, and that very much starts to align with where you see Volvo starting to evolve even in how they build their cars. They're no longer sort of square and boxy, they're much more stylish. Safety is no longer the thing they're looking at. So that Conway's Law thing does sort of come into play from time to time.
So use the analogy for the crash test dummy.
So, Josh, I want to talk about you mentioned that relatively technology is the easier part, decision making, changing the culture. Give us a sense. You work quite a bit in financial services. How do you convince people who, for years, were worried about compliance, still are, but are now worried about I can't move this thing fast enough to give you enough features to be a competitive, financial services institute?
Yeah, and I think the interesting thing is actually there's probably a lot of guys in the financial services that are absolutely there already, right? And so it's kind of there's almost an internal battle sometimes with different parts of the organization. You mentioned the compliance guys. I think the compliance officer is often the biggest blocker, right? And not necessarily because certainly not a technological reason. Right, but often because they have a certain risk framework that they have built out over years, and although there may be a right thing to change it, actually that's going to be a lot of work for this guy and his team, right? And so some of the elements of a constraint have nothing to do with technology. The other aspect is just in a lot of cases, certainly in financial services, many of the companies have spent many years actually splitting apart their organizations. Right, so in many of the cases, they even have separate legal entities for their application development side and their infrastructure house. Well, suddenly you're asking these guys to work extremely close together, and there's been a lot of turf wars around, I want to build this, and so I'm going to build it in my entity, and then the other entity is saying, no, I'm going to build this, and I'm going to build it over here. So they built the same thing, and suddenly you're trying to make a decision on, well, which one of these two am I picking, or... So some of this has nothing to do with, because those could be valid options, both of them, right? But it becomes almost more of a political thing. And we know, given the way the political landscape of the world is at the moment, politics is always difficult and tricky, right? Right. Navigating that. And I think that's what we're really dealing with. It's some of this has, it's easy for those of us that get to play a lot in the kind of tech space. I love getting back on my tech with my guys, right? But sometimes I have to deal in that almost diplomacy world, and it's... That's tough. That's just, there's no silver bullet for that stuff. You got to go through and educate people around, well, what are we trying to do here? Actually, how do we still have the security and resilience stuff embedded in? I spent a ton of my time with CISOs actually saying, hey guys, the cloud and everything we're doing here is more secure. It's yeah. actually, you should be embracing this whole scale. You should be the one champion for this, all this, because it's going to make your life easier.
Yeah.
But that's a hard
So it's almost like we talk a lot about value mapping when building applications. You almost have to do sort of their business model mapping or their org chart mapping to figure out, like, where are going to be my bottlenecks to sort of make this evolve, make it so that app team and dev team can talk together, whether it's going to be a legal problem, it's going to be a culture problem, and so forth, I would think.
Yeah, I also think that the drive's coming from a different direction these days as well. You know, I mean, everybody talks about the disruption in business from startups and all those sorts of things. And you see a lot of the thrust or desire for new applications coming direct from the business, waking up and recognizing that somebody else is eating their lunch who 6 months ago didn't exist as a business. And to a lot of these more mature organizations who have all these mature processes in place, that's a really difficult step change. So the introduction of these types of technologies becomes an absolute necessity, and often they stand them up in parallel to their existing business. Nobody's going to flick a switch overnight and move their entire trading business into containers, but they will start to build the new types of services to counteract the disruption using these services, because they have to, because the speed that they need to introduce them, the speed that they need to keep the change flowing in those sorts of things necessitates the need for these sorts of platforms.
Yeah. Now, you guys are all across Europe. Back in the States, people want to emulate what happens in Silicon Valley. Do you see, Europe has a lot of little pockets, the UK has financial services, the Nordics have a ton of software background from days past, Eastern Europe's got that, manufacturing in Germany. Do you see certain pockets where people are trying to emulate a region, or do they take advantage of the resources in their region to help get over some of these things?
Absolutely. But I would actually argue, I think certainly in my patch in financial services, I would argue our European clients are leading. So I have a global role, so I also travel a lot with our US clients, and our European clients are leading. I have European banks who are rebuilding their core banking into microservices on top of PaaS. I don't see any of my US clients doing that, right? So the reality is actually, I'm not sure there's this whole lead out of Silicon Valley going on here. I think Europe, certainly in financial services, have really taken a charge in the last 12, 18 months. My clients have gone absolutely wild on this topic, and for various different reasons. But I actually think some of the regulatory pressure happening in Europe, certainly in financial, I'm talking a lot of financial services. I know I'll let the other guys talk about other industries, but the regulatory stuff is pushing these guys over the edge, and they're having to. GDPR is coming in, and you're going to have a better system than the old stuff. And actually, it's easy to maintain if you're on something like OpenShift.
Interesting. Right, so. Yeah. You're in the software defined world, but on the network thing, which people like to blame it.
So we're based in San Francisco, so that's right. So we do a lot of work with the Silicon Valley, web, large scale web companies,
right.
And I think a lot of them are leading in many ways, but I see just as much innovation out here, and I think we see, broadly, the activity in Europe is just as strong in North America. But I definitely see the organizational challenges, and what I've seen is where customers have been most successful is where they've literally broken apart the silos, created a cloud team, and that cloud team is tasked with making this new technology work. And where that hasn't been the case, the projects invariably go off the rails.
Right. So you've got to have an ability to do that locally in the culture.
Yeah.
Yeah, you had a question?
May I have
yell. Yeah. We'll repeat it.
I try to be loud. I'm from Deutsche Börse and clearing IT, and I perfectly agree to your point. My part is half of the time is CISO stuff. The other stuff is, virtualization, cloud, two vectors here. On one hand, if you standardize your continuous integration, including security scans and your deployment, through this standardization, you can create security baselines, which makes it easier then for a variety of products. This is the technical aspect, and I agree is that some of those
cloud
providers have a better infrastructure than most companies. On the other hand, we have in the last years here in Europe a lot of deep dives into practical securities from our regulations. That means nowadays a regulator will come, BaFin or the EZB, European Central Bank, and visit you, and they bring in your experts into your house. And then you see also that the old good systems are not so shiny at all. Yeah? So this affects the whole bandwidth of installations you have. So now you have to see what is the best path through all these diplomacy. I perfectly agree, but on one hand, which is really blocking is a legal aspect, which is often underestimated. At the end, a regulator wants to have the potential possibility to seizure you or your data. And this is especially very difficult in the cloud, especially for banking services. Trading, it's a little bit different, but for health data, for clearing, which is at the end a large bank, it's very, very difficult, and there we are looking for solutions, for sure, but this is a legal aspect.
Yeah, Diane, I think he just volunteered to be the head of the regulatory SIG.
I really spent a lot of time. I'm a physicist, so I see it as a multidimensional problem, and you have to find an optimal path through it. Yeah. So diplomacy is one part, and the other part is really where you have to work together with the regulation offices here. That's very important.
It's definitely the case that
and a lot of work. It's in any case.
Yeah, a lot of the compliance standards need updating to take into account these new technologies. We have a lot of conversations with the security teams that come in and validate designs that we'll work on with the cloud architecture teams, and they'll say, okay, great. So where's the VLAN separation? And we try and explain, no, we do much finer grain. Policy-based traffic isolation, and this is why it's so much better. And where's the VLAN? Section 16 point something needs. I need to be able to identify the VLAN. Right. Yeah. Right. So I think the frameworks are in place for these standards all to be extended, but that work has still to be done.
Yeah.
It's interesting, and to that point around the regulators. It's interesting that if I go back a few years, the regulators really wouldn't have been bringing a consulting or SI player like myself into their offices on a regular basis. And I'm getting a ton of calls to fly out to Latin America and all over Europe to speak with the regulators because they're recognizing now, actually, they need a lot of education and a lot of advice to understand things like OpenShift. Because suddenly they're realizing, well, actually, I'm trying to regulate all these financial services firms and I don't understand this technology. And the technology has fundamentally shifted the environment I'm trying to regulate. And so that I actually find that a really interesting thing. Absolutely, I think the regulators are there. And a number of them, I mean, some of them have gone public, like the Dutch regulator, I would argue is probably the one ahead of everybody in the world. And they're really open and kind of embracing a lot of this stuff. But, and I know I can quote them because they quoted themselves publicly, so I'm not getting in trouble there. But I really think this space has moved so quick in the last few years that this, actually, that is why the pace of adoption around things like OpenShift is just going crazy now at the moment, right? Because a lot of these barriers are being broken down. What I see interesting as well is that there's the increased collaboration and the speed even that Red Hat is rolling OpenShift compared to the old days of RHEL, right? The speed at which you guys are bringing stuff directly from Kubernetes into OpenShift, that shows as well just the pace of the stuff that's going on. Now, I think the security space is the really next one where we're going to see a lot more stuff being built into OpenShift. I know you guys have done a great job already working so that some of that, but to me, I still think there's some additional stuff to come there for, particularly as we look forward for more regulation, not less, right?
Yeah. So I'm going to skip ahead to the next sort of topic here. When we all sort of come in to these events and we pat ourselves on the back because there's twice as many people at this event as there was in Seattle and as many as there was in San Francisco and in Austin, the expectation is it's going to be twice as many. We also all went through the days when VMware would release once a year and you struggled to keep up with, and then the OpenStack community with releasing every 6 months and people were struggling to keep up with that, and we're now releasing every 3 months and Docker is every couple of months, and people sometimes want to beat up Red Hat because we're going to announce version 3.5 and 1.6 Kubernetes is going to get announced, and they go, why are you 2 or 3 months behind? What is wrong with you? I'm curious as your guys' take, how are you keeping up with all these projects that, you know, on one hand, like Clayton talked about, we want to make them stable and boring, and on the other hand, we want to keep up with them in terms of new features. How, you know, give us a sense of how do you deal with 3 month upgrades? Or
I think the some of the challenges addressed because Kubernetes and certainly OpenShift are abstract a little bit further up. I mean, you touched on VMware and, you know, keeping up to date with VMware's releases and so on and so forth. That was so intrinsically baked into the physical infrastructure itself, mm-hmm. and the lack of things like software-defined networking via Calico or anybody else. That made it an incredibly difficult job and a highly disruptive job to just keep flowing that infrastructure moving forward. I think with the tooling and on all of the processes that are coming from Kubernetes itself and from Red Hat around OpenShift, the ability to be able to roll forward infrastructure as opposed to upgrade infrastructure is a key attribute, so that you've got this whole traceability to roll back in the event of an issue. The whole fact that you can do rolling upgrades as well. These things were traditionally difficult in an old traditional virtualized world. The challenge as a service provider is how you feed that confidence level into the consumer as well.
Yeah.
You know, and I think, you know, with things like OpenShift sat on top of Kubernetes and it being a predominantly a developer experience, the developers are going to start to gain a level of confidence with how they're deploying their application, how they're distributing their applications, the knowledge that they'll gain from using that platform will help them understand that the platform itself rolled in an upgrade underneath it is not necessarily hugely disruptive to the application, assuming that they've distributed their application in a correct and thoughtful manner. I think all of those things help now with moving together at the pace of change of the technology. I think we'll always, you know, just like Clayton said, you know, there's a soaking period between a Kubernetes major release and an OpenShift major release. From a service provider perspective and a consumer perspective, you can expect a similar sort of pause while they choose to roll that forward. There has to be sufficient technical change in the product as well to warrant wanting to move, you know, not necessarily move to 3.5, maybe they wait to 3.6 because they're waiting for some specific component. It doesn't always necessarily need to follow the same release cadence so long as you keep the whole roll forward model going.
Perspective.
My perspective, well, we've been using like OCP since 3.3 and rolling upgrading now from 3.2 to 3.3 and 3.4. Now 3.4 finished last week, and of course sometimes there are issues. There will always be issues, but then we file a ticket with Red Hat, we fix it, something in the playbook. We use like the standard playbooks, a little bit configured for our needs and what we need. But when we find an issue, we just take it up and it's fixed, and hopefully we contribute so that others can do it. And I'm a big fan of, if something hurts, you should do it often. Like, so if you upgrade often, then you kind of, you know how to do it, you know how to handle this, that something can fail. So we kind of, our strategy is kind of we want to follow the releases that come, but of course we first deploy them in one of our testing clusters that we don't run in production, and then we test things there, and we of course investigate that everything will work as expected, and sometimes we need to hold back to fix some things because sometimes there are changes, so. But it works pretty well, I guess.
And on the aspect as well of choice, I don't know whether that's your know, particularly in project or on the kind of major release type stuff. Am I skipping to the next question?
No, that's okay.
But I think that fast pace of change, these two really relate, which is there's a number of customers that are making that decision and saying, well, actually, I've got some stuff further upstream that I prefer, and then I'm swapping that out of the stack the key for OpenShift is modularity, I think. You know, because there are certain customers that want some of that stuff that maybe isn't the one that the main part of the community wants. And I think there's just got to be the ability to, you know, that's got to continue to be there.
Right.
And the trickiness of picking some of those, you know, that's always got to be down to the individual use cases. But I agree, in terms of actually the fast pace of change, personally, I think it's a good thing, right? Because, as you say, if you actually do it often, you get better at it, and you manage a lot of that, you know, in a much easier way.
Yeah.
Certainly, I'd say OpenShift upgrades are actually easier than as we go and look back, you know, at some of the things you were also saying, right? So.
Yeah, and I'd love to get folks' feedback. I know we have active discussions about there are things we've done in OpenShift for a while. So, you know, templates did certain things about how you described applications. Helm has sort of evolved as the thing within CNCF that people are using more and more. We're having open discussions about do we make that the default? Do we make that an add-on similar to what we're doing around CNI, where you can plug in Calico, you can plug in, Open vSwitch. You can. So I think we're also having those active conversations. It's around monitoring. It's about charts. It's about a bunch of different areas of what should we make the default? What should we look to CNCF to be the project, even if it's an early incubating project? And I think we've got to figure that out. I think we would love to get feedback from people as to how early do you want those pushed back into them? When would you like to see us wait for them to become stable and sort of align with the stability of OpenShift? And so any feedback you've got, feel free to give it to us sort of after this. We'd love to hear some of that.
Yeah, I think one thing we have to always be aware of when you're talking about new technologies is, you know, technology adoption curve. And most of the people we work with so far, early adopters, and the customers want to be at the leading edge. That's why they're getting involved early. But I think we're kind of reaching that inflection point or the chasm, right, where we're getting to the point where it's much more mainstream adopters, and they just expect, and this may be a good segue into the next area, right, that, you know, they're just expecting it to work out of the box, and they don't necessarily want, you know, the latest release all the time. But I think one of the things that this community's done really well is that actually set a pretty high quality bar for each release. I mean, I don't hear a lot of moaning and whining about major issues with each new Kubernetes or OpenShift release. Mostly the mainstream things work, and I saw some comments recently about how the Kubernetes community talks about alpha and beta feature. Mm-hmm. Labeling,
right.
And Kubernetes alpha is what everyone else calls a beta. The Kubernetes beta is what everyone else calls production ready, right?
Yeah.
So, I think we have been pretty good about keeping that quality bar up. And there are other projects out there that release fast and break stuff and don't necessarily go back and fix what they've broken. And and that does create some bad blood. But I feel really good about this community that we're in here.
Yeah, and I'll throw out one thing. There'll be an announcement. Is it going out today about what the work that?
It went out.
So there's a. We did a bunch of work. Red Hat did a bunch of work last KubeCon. We just did finish some work this KubeCon around scalability. So people ask all the time. I know it's got Google DNA and Google scales to web scale, but give me some details. We just published another 1,500 node. 248 node. 2048 node scalability OpenShift Kubernetes paper that'll be out on the CNCF page. So if you're curious about some of that, details about it, all that's got published today. Guys, I'm gonna sort of wrap up. Gonna give you all sort of the last word. I'll just go down the line. Sort of last bit of feedback for these folks about either working with Kubernetes, working with OpenShift, taking on a new project. Just any guidance for these folks in the last minute or so that we've each got. Go ahead and start. Josh, you can start, or Andrew, you can start. Either way.
Okay, I'll start then. I think one, certainly in terms of experience with my customers, it's a lot quicker to actually get involved with this and adopt. So I think they're increasingly less talk and more action will actually prove to really get you going quicker. I think don't underestimate that cultural element of this that is really difficult. In terms of the mindset change. But I think the reality, and to your point, maybe on that scalability, one of the things I'm really excited is we've got some massive scale in a couple of the, particularly Kubernetes, and now increasingly on some of our OpenShift deployments that we've had with customers. And that point around the fast pace versus the kind of resilience as, or scalability elements. I think Kubernetes at the moment has it really right, because I think we've seen large scale without too much difficulty, right? We're used to kind of being brought in because it's complex and difficult and have to clean up a bunch of mess, and actually there's been a lot less mess to clean up with some of these deployments. So,
yeah.
I don't know. I personally, that's what I would bring from the, you know, I think the community's moving along at a good pace where we actually got something that is relatively stable.
Darren?
Just adding to that, because I agree with what was said. I think the other thing is that the adoption's getting easier and easier and easier of Kubernetes and OpenShift. The work that the community's put in around how to adopt these tools is incredible. The quality of the documentation, the actual automation tooling around bringing these services up is so quick. And ultimately, what you get is an incredibly powerful tool. The other thing is that the ecosystem that wraps around Kubernetes and OpenShift is getting stronger day by day by day. We've talked about Calico. I mentioned there are tons and tons of organizations that are building value-added services that when you plug that in to the core of a system, all of a sudden you finish up with this solution that you feel confident with, that you can give to your developers, and then your developers can start to build true value at a pace that they quite literally have never been able to do before.
Yeah, I can just echo kind of what Josh said earlier about the culture change. We see that as well a lot, but the technical aspect, there are issues there as well, but the culture change is it's what hits it most, really. Like, for instance, our ops guys are used to patching. They have patching strategies. You should patch so often. Now we come here when Docker is it's not the same Java. We're in a Java shop. You can't patch Java in a Docker container. It's very immutable. And they say, what? Then how do we patch? So we need to kind of figure out how to do that. And so many people have solved it. We have solved it. But it's kind of something you need to think about. It's there are new issues as well. I would just recommend everybody to go play with it. Use Minishift, use OC Cluster App or anything, and just go play with the simple APIs, because it's really powerful.
Cool. So maybe a slightly different way of looking at things. We talk about the community, we talk about open source and all the great things it brings. I think, I caution people not to think that open source equals free. It's going to take a lot of resources, and I see people thinking, I'll just download these projects, put them together, and try it out, and hitting a wall fairly quickly. So write a check to our friends at Red Hat to help you out. Write a check to us, whatever. Come and work with the vendors, and I think don't struggle on your own. And I think there's an expectation that an open source community will give a level of support that it's not really geared up to. And that's where folks like Red Hat come in.
Cool. Gentlemen, thank you for your time and your insight and your expertise. And we are on a break, I believe.
Yes. We've. Thank you.